Well, joining me now on the other side of this story, or the other half of this story, is former Homeland Security Secretary under President Obama. It is Jay Johnson. Secretary Johnson, good to see you.
Thanks for having me.
Let me start with a question about what the president is asking Mexico. He wants Mexico to improve its enforcement in some form or another. What can Mexico do that it is not doing now?
Good question. Well, first I have to say that if you want Mexico, a nation of 126 million people, to do something, I don't believe that offending their national honor, trying to browbeat them into doing what you want to do is the right approach through tariffs. In 2014, Chuck, you remember the spike we had in early summer. May 2014, we had 60,000 apprehensions on our southern border. These days, it's 100,000 a month. But we had 60,000 in 1 month. And one of the things we did was work constructively with the government of Mexico to prevail upon them to put more assets, more people on their southern border with the Northern Triangle. They did that in July 2014, and that was a direct conversation between me and my Mexican counterpart, Miguel Osorio Chong, and it was a president-to-president conversation. And we saw a downturn in the numbers almost immediately after that, such that by August 2014, the spike was pretty much over, and the numbers stayed low for at least the next year. 2015 was the second lowest number we saw since 1972. So there are things the Mexican government can be doing with our help, with our encouragement, but through constructive engagement with that country.
Let me ask you this, though. Last night, the acting Homeland Security Secretary, when they were briefing us in the press about why they're doing this, he did note that when you compare this month of May, he said there were 4,500 people a day that have crossed the border illegally or arrived at ports of entry without documents. In May of 2017, it was 700 a day. He said this was going to be the highest number in at least 12 years for any single month of May. And I know we're in a peak season here, and it likely is starting to go down. I mean, you had said before you thought this was a crisis. Is it fair to call this a crisis?
Yeah, it's a crisis, Chuck, in a number of respects. And first and foremost, it's a crisis in Central America because of the poverty, the violence, the drought there, the lack of jobs, the corruption. It is and has been a crisis for quite a while in Central America. When you see numbers at these levels of 100,000 a month, 4,000 a day, it's a crisis in terms of our own border security personnel to deal with it. It's a crisis in the communities on both the Mexican and U.S. side to absorb those kinds of numbers, to take in those kinds of populations. It's a crisis in terms of the humanitarian assistance that Catholic Charities and others are providing in Texas. And so, without a doubt, these numbers at these levels are simply not sustainable, and not enough people, in my judgment, are saying to this president and this administration, plainly, what you are doing is wrong. We're on target, I'm told, in the month of May to see numbers like we've seen in March and April.
I think people did tell him he was wrong, and they've all been summarily fired.
Well, this was the president's central issue on which he campaigned in 2016. And he's failing at the effort. The numbers we're seeing month to month are the highest we've seen in 12 years. So plainly, what he's doing is not working. Plainly, migrants have not been deterred from coming through Mexico into the United States to our southern border. And he's not turning them around. And so I believe that people in DHS at the White House need to really take a hard look at what they're doing and decide they need to go back to basics and perhaps even get some fresh perspectives from people like myself who've had to manage and own this problem for a period of years before they came to office.
Look, there's plenty of speculation as to what's motivated the president to do this. I think there's some that obviously this issue bothers him constantly, and he'll get the daily reports about apprehensions and things like that.
Yep.
And there's also the issue of Robert Mueller. It's possible he wants to just send a message to his base. Hey, don't forget why you want me here. I'm the only one talking about that issue in a way that you like hearing. And perhaps there's a lot of different ways on this. But this idea that it's a response to the Mueller report, what What kind of impact would that have on DHS staff, by the way?
Well, first of all, I can't make sense of the decision-making process. You know, I'm listening to your lead-in. I was thinking to myself, it's just another Friday in the Trump presidency. I can't make sense of it all. What we're going through right now, in my judgment, has to be demoralizing to the people in Washington at DHS and, frankly, on the front lines who are trying to adopt a consistent policy, to bring a consistent response and approach to what plainly is an unprecedented in modern times situation. And we need to continue, by the way, to invest in the poverty and violence and eradicate the poverty and violence through a program we started in 2016 in the last year of the Obama administration to eradicate the poverty and violence. Yeah. And the president has suspended that aid, which I think is the exact wrong thing to do. So we've got to start at the source. Right. A lot of people don't want to hear that. This is not a simple, easy, quick fix.
Right. Very quickly, you're not one of those very highly partisan Democrats, if you will. But I am curious, as you see this debate play out in the Democratic Party over impeachment, do you have an opinion?
Well, I have been of the view that this is a matter for the electorate. With an election 17 months away, there comes a point when impeachment really becomes an academic act, particularly when you know that you need two-thirds of the Senate to convict. Mm-hmm. And it really should be up to the voters to do their job to decide whether or not President Trump deserves a second term. I watched very closely the statement from Director Mueller. I read his report, like Debbie did, several times, in particular Part 2. For the life of me, I don't understand what Director Mueller is trying to tell us. Is he trying to tell us that but for the policy, he would have indicted the president? Or is he trying to tell us there are arguments for and against, but I don't have to decide because he can't be indicted anyway?
Right.
The statement on Wednesday seemed to suggest it was more the former and not the latter, which adds momentum to what I see as a growing effort in the House Democratic Caucus to call for impeachment. So the sand is shifting. You showed a number of statements, but the ground under which they're operating is shifting, plainly.
That's for sure. Hello, YouTubers. If you're watching this, it means you've checked out our channel, so thank you. Now do me a favor. Subscribe by clicking on that button down there. Click on any of the videos to watch the latest interviews and highlights from MTP Daily and MSNBC. You can get more Meet the Press content every morning in the First Read newsletter. If you're tired of content that you don't know anything about where it came from, you don't have to have that problem with us. NBC News, MSNBC, MTP, and the Meet the Press mindset right here for you on YouTube. Subscribe now.